The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Well, we have come to praise our God. We have come to pray to our God, and we have come to hear our God speak to us. Our God has done great things. And the greatest thing that our God has done is send Jesus Christ to live and to die and to rise from the grave, to ascend to heaven, and to send his Holy Spirit to restore us and to be with us always. And it's through the power of that Spirit and in the presence of Jesus Christ that we can gather together before the great throne of our God. In Psalm 126, the psalmist calls all of Israel, calls all of us today to remember and to proclaim the great things that God has done. As we continue in worship, I invite us to read aloud these words from Psalm 126 and invite you to say aloud or in your heart the bolded print. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with
laughter.
we shall bow and tongue proclaim. Jesus, Jesus, you are Savior, you are Lord, and you are God. Let's sing it together. Jesus, 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 at the mention of your name, every knee shall bow, tongue proclaim. His name is Jesus, wonderful Jesus. You are Savior, you are Lord, and you are God. One more time to the Lord, let's sing it together. Jesus, Jesus, at the mention of your name, every knee shall bow and tongue proclaim. His name is Jesus, wonderful Jesus. Savior, you are Lord, and you are God.
Hallelujah.
So we sing, you're the only living God.
You're the only living God.
You're the only worthy God.
Let's join our hearts together in prayer using the words that are on the screen.
O Lord our God, we are overwhelmed by your love and saving goodness.
You have done great for us.
Like Miriam and Moses at the Red Sea, we sing of your deliverance.
You have done great for us.
Like Nehemiah at the rebuilding of the temple, we declare your covenant faithfulness.
You have done great things for us.
Like Peter at Pentecost, in the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, we claim your promises.
You have done great things for us.
But
God of grace, we confess that in our prosperity, we have been unfaithful to our covenant with you and one another. Like makers of golden calves, we idolize money, power, greed, and convenience. Like those who have forgotten the law, we have served our own self-interests. Like cynics denying your power, we have trusted in our own strength.
O God, our Savior, to whom we belong,
turn our mourning into dancing.
As Jacob was reconciled to Esau, bridge the gap between peoples and nations.
Turn our mourning into dancing.
As Esther saved her people from destruction, put an end to warfare and violence.
Turn our mourning into dancing.
As Jesus rose from the grave, lift us from doubt and despair and fill us with life.
Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like the water courses in the Negev.
We will sing. Would you clap your hands as you declare praises to the Lord is worthy, and we give him all the praise. Sing, Lord, you're worthy,
Lord, you're worthy,
and we give you,
and we give you the praise.
Lord, you're worthy,
Lord, you're worthy,
and we give you,
and we give you the praise.
Always make it away,
always make it away,
and we give you,
and we give you the praise.
Lord, you're worthy,
Lord, you're worthy,
and we give you,
and we give you the praise.
Lord, you're worthy.
House of the Lord. Amen?
Amen?
This is God's house. He's the one who sent out the invitations. He's the one who gathered us here. And he greets us this morning and he says, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ through the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. And all God's people say, amen. Amen. And because God has greeted us and invited us into his house, we get to take that peace and pass it to each other. So with a hug, a handshake, a high five, whatever is culturally appropriate to you, greet each other and say, the peace of the Lord be with you always, or simply God's peace. I forgot to add the wave of peace. There was a lot of waving of peace going on, like, oh, I didn't know you were going to be here. Hey, hey, what's up? That was great. That was great. We have more people coming in. So if you've got a seat open near you, would you just put a hand up? Wow, lot. So those of you who are coming in who are seatless, these are people who are here to welcome you. We got seats right up here, two in the front. You pay extra for those at a concert, but here, free. Two right up here. Who else needs one? Got a couple right here. I saw some open ones over here in the zone. Right? Just come on in. Come on in. Luke's pointing some out right here. And in the choir loft. Come on down. Come on down. Does everyone who want a seat now have a seat? Are we good? Are we full up? All right. Good. Let's pray together. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, for you have gathered us here, your sons from the west, your daughters from the east. You have said to the north, give them up, to the south, do not hold back. Everyone who is called by my name and gathered here. We praise you that you are a God who gathers. We praise you that you are a God who redeems. That though we come from different cultures, we speak different languages, we come from different denominations and traditions, we are one in Jesus Christ. He is the one who has redeemed us, who has shed his blood so that we can be set free. Thank you, Jesus. We praise you, Holy Spirit, for you are the one who animates and equips and empowers us to do the work you've called us to do. And you are also, in your mercy, the one who convicts us and calls us and challenges us and is relentless with us. Thank you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, for your pursuit of us. As we open your word this day, we pray, Holy Spirit, that you will make an old, old story fresh and alive and new. Come, Holy Spirit, and fill our hearts. We pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord, and all God's people say, amen. We're looking at Isaiah 43, and you'll find it helpful to have the text in front of you. The black books are the Bibles. If you're in the front row, they're under your seats. Isaiah 43 can be found beginning on page 585, and then we have a quick flip to 586. Feel free to use a tablet or a phone, or that's more convenient and more what you're used to, that's fine. So we'll be reading Isaiah 43, verses 1 through 7. Hear the word of the Lord. But now, thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt as your ransom, Ethiopia and Seba in exchange for you, because you are precious in my sight and honored, and I love you. I give people in return for you, nations in exchange for your life. Do not fear, for I am with you. I will bring your offspring from the east and from the west. I will gather you. I will say to the north, give them up. And to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from far away and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. This is the word of the Lord. As a college chaplain, one of the questions that comes often into my office is this one: where do I belong? It takes different forms. Sometimes it's, I'm having a hard time making friends. Sometimes it's, I was a starter for 4 years on my high school team and I got cut here. Sometimes it's, I'm a senior and I have no idea what I'm doing next. The question takes different forms, but at the heart, it's, where do I belong? It's a common question for those between the ages of 18 and 22, but if we're honest, we don't outgrow it. We move to a new city, we try to make new friends, we try to get invested in hobbies, and we're still asking the question, where do I belong? We try out a vocation for a while, we're not sure if it fits us, we wonder if there's something else out there, we think, where do I belong? We go to a worship conference in January and it's snowing outside and we think, where do I belong? It's not here. I think this question is particularly poignant for those of us who are professionally religious. Because we work and live and minister to and with these communities where we're trying to get everybody to belong. Let's talk about hospitality one more time. Let's talk about having meals together one more time. Let's make a space for more people one more time. Let's welcome in the stranger. Let's get everybody to belong. And we're in the middle of this, and we're pretty sure that we belong. We're pretty sure we're right in the hub. We're pretty sure we're in the center until we have a new idea. And it doesn't really matter what the new idea is about. The new idea could be about small groups. Instead of assigning everybody to a household and making them like people that they have nothing in common with, what if we had like small groups that were around affinities and they were short term and people could kind of sign up and change and be flexible and not overwhelmed? What if we did that? Or, you know, we've got this parsonage and it's just sitting here and we use it for different activities, but what if we said, let's make this an intentional living community? And what say we had college students or people right after college who lived there and served? What would that be like? Or let's try some global song. You know, let's do something from France, from Taze, and next time something from the United States, the gospel tradition, and maybe the week after that, a Korean blessing song. Let's just try some stuff up. It doesn't matter what the idea is. The idea is new. And it's yours. And suddenly, this group of people that you've worked so hard to make connections with and lead and bring together is circling the wagons, and you are on the outside. And that hurts. And so you think, well, maybe if they don't like my idea, they still like me, right? They still like me. And so you stand at the back of church waiting for the handshake line for someone to say something other than good morning. Could you say you liked the sermon? It would hurt you to say that out loud. Would somebody say they appreciated the offertory? Would somebody say the choir sounded really good today? Would somebody say, I love that arrangement. Oh, everything fell out and you just had the drums. That was awesome. Please, like me, like me, like me. And we look for affirmation and appreciation from these people that we've worked so hard to bring in, and now we're on the outs and we realize we don't belong. We're an employee. And then we feel stuck. We feel stuck. And so we lean into behaviors that bring us a little comfort. We hang out with our friends, Ben and Jerry, a little more than we should. We count down the hours until Downton Abbey's, mostly so that we can tweet and communicate with everyone else who's watching Downton Abbey. And we enjoy that glass of wine or two or three. Because we're lonely. And we don't belong. We feel stuck. We feel captive. Here, with these people in this place, stuck. We don't belong. We feel stuck. That's how the people of Judah felt when they first read these words from Isaiah 43. Many of you know that the first half of Isaiah is about judgment. It's about stuff is coming down. You guys have blown it. You have been disobedient. You haven't cared for the poor. You haven't practiced Sabbath. You haven't done any of the things God asked you to do. And judgment is coming. Jerusalem is going to be leveled. Your population will be decimated. People that you love will be killed or carried off into exile. The first part of the book is all about judgment. And then judgment comes. And the people are captive. And the country smells different from home. And the country has different weather from home. And different food and different language. But that's not it. They're prisoners. They're captives. Their families can be split up. Their sons taken to be slaves for someone else. Their daughters taken to things that they don't want to think about. They are captives. They are not in control. They are stuck. Where do they belong? This word from Isaiah 43 comes to these people. And whether it was written in anticipation long before these things came to pass, or whether it was written during the time that they were in exile, we will let the Bible scholars debate. But Isaiah 43 is a word of comfort for people who are stuck. And it begins with this great turn, this great phrase, but now. But now. You were stuck. You were captive. But now, thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, do not fear. Now, if you're a captive, your default imagination, your default emotion is fear. That is where you reset to. You wake up in the morning, fear. You go to bed at night, fear. Because your life is not your own. You are afraid all the time. Anybody can do anything to you. Your default is fear. And so if God's telling his captive people that they don't have to fear, he better give them good reasons why not. And he does. Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. Now, redeem, redeemer, redemption, that's a loaded word for the people. That's a loaded word that they know about. That's goel. Goel in Hebrew is the word for redeemer, sometimes translated as kinsman redeemer. It's the one who steps in when you're in trouble. It's the one who steps in and takes names when you're in trouble. It's the one who says, I will avenge the wrongs that have been done to you and I will put things right. I am your redeemer. And many of us know the story in the book of Ruth, where she is in desperate need. She is poor. She is foreign. She has nothing. And Boaz steps in as her kinsman redeemer. And he is kind and he is loving and he avenges what was put wrong and he works to put everything right. God says, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I'm doing this for you. I step in for you. And then he says, I have called you by name. You are mine. One of the ways a captor shows his power over a captive is to rename the captive. Some of you remember the story of the four who were taken from Jerusalem to Babylon, and they were renamed Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, Belteshazzar. What were their Hebrew names? Do we even remember? Hananiah, Azariah, Mishael, Daniel. Daniel keeps his name through most of the book, mostly because he wrote it. Which is a good news for all of you named Daniel, because you could have been named Belteshazzar. A captor renames a captive and says, I name you now, you belong to me, like a bully on the playground to a weaker child. I name you. I give you a nickname. I give you a name that undermines you. I give you a name that expresses your weakness and my power. And so to his captive people, God says, I name you. I call you by name. You are mine. And because of that, he says, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. The rivers will not overwhelm you. And of course, here he is saying to them, do you remember? Do you remember the Red Sea? Do you remember back to the flood? Do you remember the Jordan? Do you think I only have one Exodus in me? Do you remember? When you pass through the fire, you will not be burned. The flame will not consume you. I will be with you. Nebuchadnezzar looks into the furnace and he says, wasn't there three guys that we threw in the furnace? And there's God, oh yes, king, there were three. We counted, there were three. Then why is it when I look and I see four and the fourth one looks like the son of a god? When you pass through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, he says, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. And then this, I give Egypt as your ransom. Again, a reference to the Exodus. Again, a remembering time for them. Do you remember the last plague? Do you remember the cost that Egypt paid so that you could be free? Do you remember? Do you remember that? Well, this time I'm not just giving up Egypt. I'm giving up Ethiopia. I'm giving up Seba. I'm going all in for you. I give nations in exchange for you because you are honored and precious in my sight and I love you. And then there's this beautiful image where he's saying to people whose families have been fractured and spread out, I will bring the sons from afar, the daughters, the north, the south, give them up, gather them in. This is the family. Everyone whom I've called by my name, whom I created and formed, you're mine. Fierce, crazy love, Isaiah 43. Crazy love, insane love, fierce love, relentless love for the people of Judah. He's saying to them, I will do everything it takes to bring you home. I will do everything it takes to help you remember where you belong. You belong to me. You belong to me. You. Belong to him. That same crazy, fierce, reckless love demonstrated in Isaiah 43, that's for you. That's for you. Jesus says in Mark 10, I came, the Son of Man came to give his life as a ransom for many. It's the only time Jesus uses that word. And scholars think that's hearkening back to this passage of Isaiah 43 where he's reminding them of the one who gave it all so that they could be set free. I give my life for you. I give my life so you can be set free. I give my life so you can belong. Jesus did not give his life so that you could belong to a church or so that the church could belong to you. Jesus gave his life so that you could belong to him. Yes. He is the one in whom we find our strength and our life and our hope. And every time we start seeking that out from members of our community, we are going to be starved and lonely and sad. Psychiatrist and author Kurt Thompson suggests we do this instead. He says, imagine it's the end of a long day, you know, one of those days. It's the end of a long day, and you come home and you walk into your kitchen, and your three best friends are sitting at the kitchen table. And your first thought is, oh no, what's happened? But they say, no, we know you've had a bad day, and we're here. We want to hear about it. We've got snacks. We've got beverages. We are ready. We want to pray for you. We want to care for you. We love you. We're here for you. We wanted to see you. And then Dr. Thompson says, imagine that that's the Trinity. Your three best friends are sitting around the table, Father, Son, Spirit, and they are saying, eat with us, for this is where you belong. For when you were baptized, we put the name on you, the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. We have called you by name. You are mine. This is where you belong. Sit here with us and feel how much we love you. And we love you not because you are Pastor Tim, not because you are Nate, the worship leader, not because of your role. We love you because you're you. We're just kind of crazy about you. God says, I'm just crazy about you. You belong to me. You belong to me. You belong to me. Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I've called you by name. You are mine. Amen. Will you pray with me? Lord, you're worthy, and we give you the praise. Forgive us when we go seeking for affirmation or belonging in places that will never give it. Turn our hearts away from these idols and turn them back toward you. Thank you for calling us, for equipping us, and for here in this space letting us rest in the center of your love. Father, Son, and Spirit, thank you for loving us fiercely. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. There's a confession of the church, the Reformed churches, that speaks to this idea of belonging. It was written, this, by two 20-somethings named Casper and Zach. Casper and Zach were 20-somethings who knew what it meant to belong. And so let's stand together. This is Heidelberg Catechism, question and answer 1. I will read the question. I invite you to respond with the answer. Beloved, what is your only comfort in life and in death? That I am not my own, but belong, body and soul, in life and in death, to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. He has fully paid for all my sins with his precious blood, and has set me free from the tyranny of the devil. He also watches over me in such a way that not a hair can fall from my head without the will of my Father in heaven. In fact, all things must work together for my salvation. Because I belong to him, Christ, by his Holy Spirit, assures me of eternal life and makes me wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for him.
Afraid,
I am with you. I have called you each by name. Come and follow me. I will bring you home. I love you and you.
Really?
receive the blessing from the God who loves you fiercely. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
As we are leaving this place, we'll be singing a blessing song from Korea. And as we sing this song in Korea, we put your hands to one another and bless each other. So while we're singing, just try to just maybe move around a bit, and even though you don't know a person next to you, just bless each other. And then yes, let's sing it together.
Welcome to each one of you. My name is Kristen Verhulst, and I am the program manager for the 29th annual Calvin Symposium on Worship. We are so glad you are here at Calvin College and Calvin Theological Seminary, the home of the Calvin Institute of Christian Worship and the Center for Excellence in Preaching. You have traveled from a very long way, some of you. We know that there are more than 40 states and provinces represented here at the conference, and more than 40 countries outside of the US and Canada. If you are one of the 130 guests from outside the U.S. and Canada, would you stand so we can especially welcome you from those many countries? We are a very diverse group, which is just amazing. We represent more than 40 denominations and traditions, and you come to this conference playing so many different roles in worship. So we have pastors here and worship leaders, folks who serve on the worship committee. We have teachers of worship, educators, those who work in justice ministries in the church, and those who work with youth and children. We have scholars and we have students. In fact, this year we have more than 50 high schools, colleges, universities, and seminaries represented here at the conference. So if you're a student or a faculty staff member at one of those schools here at the conference, would you stand so we can recognize these students? We think that is great because this is a conference all about worshiping together and learning together. And so we'll be doing this not because we have answers here, but because we want to ask questions and learn from one another. And we hope very much that as you return to your worshiping communities at the end of the week, that you will bring these questions and insights and engage the learning back home with the people in your congregations and schools. So now it is time to begin traveling to the seminar locations. So I hope that you all have your program book here, and on page 9, you will find the schedule and the locations of the different seminars or retreats that you have registered for. So I invite you to travel first to those locations, and then once you arrive, we will have some refreshments for you to enjoy there. For those that are going to travel over to the Prince Conference Center, you're invited to get on the big bus, which is parked right outside the door here. There's two of you that are heading, or two groups that are heading off campus for retreats. You're going to head to the library lobby where you checked in to get on a big bus for those retreats. I hope it's a wonderful day, and I look forward to greeting many of you individually.